all types of nervous and freaked out. I don't know why. Pray for me, guys. Pray for me as I speak to you. Okay, this is exciting though. I'm so grateful. Anytime they ask me to do literally anything, I'm like, wow, really? Are you sure? So thank you guys for just giving me a chance to come and share my heart and my thoughts and my feelings. I don't know why I didn't bring tissue. Big crier on all things. So someone just be ready, you know, for me when that inevitably happens. But lately, all of these messages I've been hearing, I don't know what messages you've been hearing, but all of the ones I hear are all about pain all the time. And as someone who cries often, it's because there's pain all the time, you know? And so what's good about it is that it's made me comb through so much of my convictions on pain. As I shared a couple weeks ago about God being good and that being my like deepest conviction and how that's been tested during this time of moving, of transition, of change, of sadness, of all that jazz. It's really tested it in me. And so it's made me have to study out, what is the deal here? God, what is your deal here? Why are you out here trying to hurt me? Is it on purpose? What's the problem? So I'm reading all these books, and I really like books by C.S. Lewis. I like it because he's so logical, and that really helps me. You know, I like his analytical approach to things. I'm like, he's right. Don't be emotional about this. It makes sense. So I was reading this book on grief, and in it, he talks about, is God like a vet or a vivisector, right? Now, C.S. Lewis uses big words, so there's that. There's a lot of dictionary Googling going on when I read. But I was like, a vet or a vivisector? Okay, so a vivisector, it's a little bit terrifying. So a vivisector conducts experiments on live animals. So when you dissect something, you're, you know, cutting it up and studying it, but you dissect it because it's dead. When you vivisect it, you do this and it's alive. And so the book is harsh. It's a harsh look at God. It was like, is he just doing crazy experiments on us for his own whatever, just to see what happens? Or is he like a vet where he's actually trying to heal these animals for some reason? And I was like, oh, he said that out loud. I can't say bad things about God like that out loud because then he'll hear me. Like, you know, I was like, whoa, that's bold, bro. And so he put it out there. Is he, what is he? And it was helpful because he talked about how, well, like I said, a lot of this you're going to have to follow me on because you read it and you're like, that's crazy, but it makes sense. Is he shared that with pain, if you're crying out, stop this, stop what's hurting me, God, stop what's hurting me. And he said, if God is unkind, or evil, or just doing this for some kind of sport or whatever, he might actually be won over by your pleas to stop. Because everybody has windows. You know, he talks about a drunkard has windows of sobriety. He's like, if God's just evil, he'll have a window of maybe mercy and be like, okay, I guess you've had enough, I'll stop. But he was saying, if God is good, it would be more evil for him to stop in the middle of the operation. And he was saying, because if God is like a doctor, like, it's wild, huh? I was like, oh my God, like, what is my life, you know? And so, but he talked about like, well, if he's a doctor who's doing this for our ultimate healing, and he stops in the middle of the operation because you want him to, then all the pain leading up to that point is pointless. It means nothing because it will not result in any kind of healing, that he has to finish his work, and that it would be wrong of him to stop whatever pain you're going through, so that because you just like don't like it at the time. So this is the kind of stuff I've been studying, right? Like just like heavy, upsetting things. But it's good because it's helped my conviction on, you know what, pain doesn't disqualify God from being good. You know, that it's part of his goodness, you know, it's part of his healing. He's not just poking and doing experiments, he actually wishes to heal me. But the negative effect that pain has had is, at least in this current, you know, season, is the first thing it did is it just shattered my why. My why do I do what I do was just in pieces, just all over the place. I'm already gonna cry. But it was like, it was just a mess. I was like, I don't know. Why do I go to church? Why do I do what I do? Why do I share my faith? Why do I love people? Why do I exist? You know, like just why, right? And so some of you guys might remember one of the congregationals at the park, there was a time Jason was like, I was talking to somebody and they had lost their why. And I'm like, oh, that's me. And he was like, so everybody who's been baptized this year, you know, come up here and say your name and what region you're a part of, right? And it was like a whole line of people. And I was like, oh, this is for me. Look at all the people. Some of you guys were some of those people. And I was like, this is beautiful. That's his mom and his dad. And so it was very, very helpful. But that was one effect pain had, is it just jacked up my why. My reasoning was all over the place. My motivation was just a mess. The second thing it did is it broke my ability to dream. I was like, vision. Like, I was all grossed up. Vision. Like, dream about what? Like, dream about God snatching all the things. Like, you know what I mean? You know, you just, like, bubble up just, like, terrible thoughts. And so the idea of dreaming was just far away. Far, far away. Thank you. It was just shattered. But that's not new for me. I've always had problems with dreaming. A lot of it, even just starting as a young Christian, I remember being challenged, like, what are your kingdom dreams? And I was like, I just want to go to heaven. Like, I don't know, like, save people around me. Like, and they were like, why don't you pray specifically about your dreams? And I was like, why? That seemed like, I literally said, that seems like a waste of prayer. Like I'm wasting time telling God what I want. When he knows what'll happen. I'm sure he knows things I want that I don't even know. Like, he's got it. Why do I got to talk about this? And so I've always been challenged to dream. Dreaming has always been a little bit of a difficult deal for me, you know? And so you factor in pain. Now I'm like, I stubbornly refuse to ever dream. I will never, ever think good thoughts again. You know, like that's where I can go. And that's the things I can feel. So like 10 years ago, I heard a lesson about dreaming that blew me away. I tell everybody to listen to it. I told Lizzie to listen to it not that long ago. I think Regine listened to it like 5-10 years ago herself. Some of you guys are probably there if you guys are older spiritually. And so I listened to it again recently. You know, kind of like, does this lesson still, you know, hit the way it used to? I'm like sitting there crying again. And I was like, okay, clearly we still feel these things. So what was good about it is I was like, this is what I should talk about. You know, if I'm given the opportunity to share, I should share this because it's something that is so real and relevant for me now. Now, if you go listen to the original lesson, it's probably going to be a lot different. But please do, because it's very, very good. Joe Willis is a very talented man. So this lesson is going to be called Women Who Dream. And if we start off in Hebrews chapter 11. And Hebrews 11 talks about faith, of course. Faithy faith. Okay, in Hebrews 11 in verse 1 it says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. I love the NET translation because it says that at God's command, what was visible came from the invisible. And so this is what God does, is he can pull things out of nothing. Even Romans 4:17, you can just write it down in the NET again, says that he summons things that don't exist as though they do. And so God is a dreamer. God is the ultimate dreamer. He dreamed up the universe. He dreamed up men. He dreamed up women. It came to nature. He just let loose and was making up trees and flowers and fish and animals. Like, I mean, God is a major imaginative dreamer. And what makes God so special is he turns dreams into reality. And if we want to be godly women, if we want to be godlike, then we have to learn how to turn our dreams into realities so we can be godly like him. And so tonight we're going to study out 2 Kings chapter 4. Like I said, this is going to be sort of his lesson mixed with like my whole life and everything that I like and want to talk about. So in 2 Kings chapter 4, and we're going to start in verse 8. It says, one day Elisha went to Shunem, and a well-to-do woman was there who urged him to stay for a meal. So whenever he came by, he stopped there to eat. She said to her husband, I know that this man who often comes our way is a holy man of God. Let's make a small room on the roof and put it in a bed and a table and a chair and a lamp for him so then he can stay there whenever he comes to us. One day when Elisha came, he went up to his room and lay down there. He said to his servant Gehazi, call the Shunammite. So he called her, and she stood before him. Elisha said to her, "Tell her, you have gone through all this trouble for us. Now what can be done for you? Can we speak to the king on your behalf or the commander of the army?" She replied, "I have a home among my own people." "What can be done for her?" Elisha asked. Gehazi said, "She has no son, and her husband is old." Then Elisha said, "Call her." So he called her, and she stood in the doorway. "About this time next year," Elisha said, "you will hold a son in your arms." "No, my lord," she objected. "Please, man of God, don't mislead your servant." But the woman became pregnant, and the next year, about that same time, she gave birth to a son, just as Elisha had told her. In the New Living Translation, it says, where she says, "No, my lord," it says she cried out, "Oh, man of God, don't deceive me and get my hopes up like that." And so my first point is, are you too scared to dream? Because that was her response, was, "Don't you get me hopeful again. Don't make me think happy thoughts. Don't make me think this could ever even happen for me." And so what we learned about the Shunammite woman here is that she's well-to-do, which means she's wealthy. She's good-hearted, you know, she's kind to the prophet. She's spiritual enough to be able to see a prophet, know a prophet. She's good to her husband, respectful of him. She's generous, she wants to provide, she's hospitable. Even when she says, "I have a home among my own people," she's like, "I own this house. I have a great life, sir. I don't need anything from you." And so she's completely in control of her own life and her own world. And so you would think that she was really happy. But was she? What he shows is she had suppressed dreams. She had dreams of children. And she tells him, "Don't get my hopes up." Other ways could be, "Don't go there. I'm in control of my life and my emotions. Don't go there because I can't take the hurt of dreaming about that again. The risk of failure. I don't want to live with that pain." And if she's only just learned to deal with the fact that she doesn't have kids, how dare you bring it up again? It's rude. It's hurtful for you to bring up what I obviously don't have. Don't you dare, you godly man, get me to dream and to hope. Because dreams like that don't come true, at least not for people like me, is what I envision her feeling and saying. And so for us, we avoid failure. You know, anything that looks a little bit dangerous, a little bit I might fail, I might be embarrassed, we avoid that at all costs. You know, we want to be kind of comfortably numb, where I don't want to feel embarrassed, I don't want to feel bad feelings, and so I don't want to dream. Because it hurts, and we believe that we're in control of our emotions. It's kind of like the Hulk. Like, you don't want to see me when I'm angry. You know, like, who might I become if God lets me down? What if I ask him and he says no? What if I freak out? What if I sin? What if I fall away? What if I whatever? If I ask God and he says no, I might lose control of my emotions and my walk with God. And so for her, she'd given up the dream of having children. And maybe rightly so. I mean, maybe she had miscarriages. Maybe she'd had a stillborn child. Like, we don't know what led to her childlessness. But something clearly went wrong. And so all the reasons that we have a lot of times not to dream are very justified, to us at least, you know. Like, I've got good reasons why I don't dream. Maybe it's because we were hurt in the past. Maybe it's our age. Maybe it's lack of talent. Maybe we're like, I'm just not good enough at that, you know. Maybe it's past failures. Maybe it's shame. Maybe we fell away last time, and coming back was already so much, I can't dream that big again. Maybe we hurt so many people. We're like, you don't know how many people I hurt last time. I fell down like that, and I can't do it again. And so we kind of consign ourselves to the way Judas felt. We make ourselves like him, where we condemn ourselves with just self-pity and self-loathing, and we put a death, the way he did to himself, to all of our dreams. And so for you, what dreams are you suppressing tonight? What dreams do you pretend don't exist? Because talking about it is just too hard. It's too vulnerable. It's too much. What dreams are it? For some of us, we're like, no, I'm happy. I am happy to die the way I am. I just want to make it to heaven. Anytime I always say that to people, they're like, you're not doing well. I remember one time, and the many times I was not doing well, we were in Russia, you know, missions conferences, they just take you places, right? And so I'm in Moscow for some reason. And like, I'm in Russia. And it was great because Mike always reaches out to Kip, who leads all our churches, and always says, can we get time together? And I'm like, you gotta leave this man alone, right? But he's in Russia, so he's kind of like, yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, got some time. So we go and we have lunch, and I'm just like all sad and pathetic. Like, I get like that. And so I was all upset. And he was kind of like, what's your guys' dream right now? And I was like, I just want to make it to heaven, you know? And I was super pregnant. I'm like 8 months pregnant. And I'm like, I just want to have a baby and go to heaven. And he was like anything else? And I was like, no, that's about it, you know? I think I brought up my discipler at the time. I was like, I think I want to, you know, be like her. I want to be a good right hand. And he was like, he's so sweet. He was like, the world doesn't need two of her, sis. It only needs one of her, and it needs one of you. And I was like, bro, I'm very emotional. Please don't say nice things to me. Like, you know, like, it's so like, ah. And so he's like, you're a weapon of war, sis. Like, he's just, you know, builds you up, right? And you're like, okay. But he was like, if you guys could go anywhere in the world and plant a church, where would you go? That is a terrifying moment when you're sitting with Kip. Because you just be like, blah, 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 and you might end up in that city. Like, wow, this really, and so I'm like, this is a big moment. And both of us, Mike and I both just sat there and we were like, I don't know, bro, we don't really dream like that anymore. We don't really think like that. And he was, you know, like horrified, right? And so he suggested, you know, a city, and then we ended up in that city. And so that was how that went. But sometimes we think we sound very surrendered, like, oh, I just want to make it to heaven. But people know that a lack of dreams, it comes from somewhere. It comes from a deadness, that something died in there, or we are currently trying to put it to death. And so for you, what is it that you're suppressing? I mean, maybe it is something hard, like having a child. Maybe it's dating. Maybe it's marriage. Maybe it's getting out of debt. We should have dreams for our life. Our life, maybe it's like, I dream of having an excellent life. My husband drives Uber constantly because he wants to get us out of debt. If your life is in shambles, it is your fault if it stays that way. Maybe it wasn't your fault that it got that way, but if it stays that way, and a church full of disciples that will help you and love you and teach you how to budget and give you ideas, okay, at some point that's on you. And so you got to have dreams for that. But maybe we suppress it. We're like, dreams, I don't want to dream about that. I just need to get by Monday through Friday. That's what I got. Maybe it's the dream of seeing someone become a Christian. You know, in a fruitful church like this, it's easy to hide and be like, yeah, we're bearing fruit. But it's like, am I bearing fruit? You know, and we can give up. We can be like, all my friends fell away. Why am I going to add more people to my little messed up church family than they might leave? You know, and so maybe that's what we're suppressing. Maybe it's a new job, leadership position, going on a mission team. Maybe it's baptizing a family member. It's the year of miracles, and you like have written that down, your little miracle thing, and you're like, we're not getting any closer. Yeah. So what dreams are you suppressing? But we've got to face our fears. We got to face it head on, because our past failures don't have to determine who we're going to be, who we are today. And, you know, fears are educated into us. You can tell when you look at children. They are, like, wild. They are absolutely wild and absolutely fearless. But it's us who slow them down and are like, be careful, you might hurt yourself, that's dangerous, don't do that. I mean, my poor daughter, she says all the time, I need to be careful, I need to be careful. And I'm like, you do need to be careful. But it's because I'm so afraid she'll hurt herself that I'm like putting that deep in her. Like whenever I go to Sarah's house, her boys are like, I can fly, right? Like they're just, I'm just like, and I'm like, maybe you can. Like, I think maybe you can. I think you actually can fly. Like, you just flew through the air, like, with the greatest of ease, you know? And so kids are born fearless, but then we put that fear up in them, you know? Yeah. And sometimes, as older Christians, we can do the same to the baby Christians, you know? We start putting fears into them. I used to dream like that. Oh, yeah, I used to be sacrificial, too. You know, we start to put our fears in there. And I know that I have wrestled with that being here more than anywhere else. And I think it's because you guys are so young and shiny and beautiful. And I can feel like, yeah, I used to like, what did I say? I said something to someone. No, I think I actually kept it in my heart. So, you know, at least that's one step. At least I didn't like pollute her. I just kept it in my own heart. But I thought to myself, I was like, yeah, they're us before all the pain. I told her, they're us before the scars of life. And it's so dangerous because we can put that fear into people. That, are you sure you want to dream like that? Are you sure you want to give it that much of your heart? Because you don't know what it hurts like later. And so we can be educated with fear. We put it into ourselves. We put it into other people. But the good thing about that is that if it can be educated in, it can be educated out. You can actually teach yourself not to be afraid anymore. You absolutely can. You can with the Bible, with godly people, and the Holy Spirit. Fears can be educated out of us. Now, I've heard people talk about different acronyms for fear. My favorite one is the false expectations appearing real. Because I like that it's an expectation. Like, I expect this to happen. And it says that that's false, and it just appears real to you. And so it's so much of our imagination. Even with horror movies, the really scary ones don't actually show you what's going on. They just let you imagine, you know, they give you sounds so that you're like, I bet this is what's happening, and it's so terrifying. When it's like, you came up with that. They didn't even have to do it. Your own imagination, your own false expectations are freaking you out. And so we need to live the life that we imagine is possible for us. Like, let's use our imaginations for good, not for evil. Like, let me imagine good things for myself and try to live that kind of life. I once heard this brother share in maybe Dubai, something like that. But he shared this, and I was like, that is so good. And I wrote it down, and I thought of it tonight. But he said that worry is a form of meditation. If we have time to meditate on our worries, we have time to meditate on the word. And I love that. And I was like, because he's right. I'm just creating scenarios. I'm hurting my own feelings. I'm having fake conversations. You know, you're in the shower arguing with nobody. Like, I'm just upsetting myself. And if I have time to meditate on this, I have time to meditate on the word of God. And so Satan loves it. You know what I mean? He loves fear. He loves doubt. This is how it began in the beginning with Eve in the garden. You know, did God really say, don't do this? Did he really say, don't do that? And he does it to us now. Did God really say that you would become something? You know, did God really say you'd be fruitful? Did he really say that you would succeed? And his whole goal is to fill us with fear and with doubt. And now, so Joe shared a story that I was like, I'm not going to share that story. That's not my life. But then it was so sweet. I was like, oh, I should tell them. So he was talking about a friend of his who had been single for a very long time, and she'd kind of given up, like, closed for business here, we're not doing that, is the way he described her. And he said him and his wife bought her a little frame with little frogs on the top of it. And it was so that every night by her bed, she had to think of her prince who would come someday. And he said that it was so hard for her to have the possibility of a failed, you know, dream stare her in the face every single night. Having to decide, am I going to pray and trust God and go on dates, even though these brothers aren't asking me on dates? Like, you know what I mean? She was like, am I going to do this? Or am I just going to be resigned to the fact that that is not for me? Don't get my hopes up, you godly man. And, you know, her story ended beautifully. She married somebody and they have kids, and yay for them, right? I don't know who this person is, so amen. But as I was thinking about that, I was like, it just made me think of the reminders I have in my own home of fulfilled dreams. Again, I feel all emotional about it. But when we moved in, we kind of just left all our stuff in Boston. We just were like, forget it. Our stuff's dumb. Let's leave all our dumb stuff. And we were like, let's get new stuff, right? No, we don't have money for new stuff. But my family was like, we'll help you get new stuff. You know, and I was like, cool. And then, you know, like a month later, we're like on the Dimitri's air mattress. Like, eventually, we got stuff, though. And so for a long time, though, we were just chilling on the ground. And so the things that Mike brought, because he kind of packed up everything and drove across the country, it was a lot of memorabilia. You know, a lot of things from the different countries we had been to, a lot of eagles from the churches that we had planted. So, you know, there were eagles for, like, Vermont and Maine and Rhode Island and New Hampshire, and then, like, Gainesville, from when we'd gone to Gainesville, Orlando, when we'd gone there, we had little plates from, like, India and Dubai, and I think I broke the Russia one, and then, like, one from, like, you know, DR, and, like, stuff from Haiti, stuff from Jerusalem, like, so we have, like, stuff, right? And I remember I was, like, like, you know, I mean, all disdainful, like, what should we even do with all this, you know, when we moved here? And he was, like, put it up places, and I was, like, why? I don't want that reminder in my face all the time. And there are times that I look at it and I feel happy memories. And there are times where I'm like, I'm going to get a bat and smash all of this. And I'm like, don't do that. Mike will be really upset if you smash all things in the house. And so I go back and forth. Not every day is a good day. But sometimes seeing it, it puts in my face, do you still have the dream? Do you still want to evangelize the world? Do you still want to go to these cities? Do you want to plant churches? Do you want to oversee them? Do you want to dream again? And every time I look at them, I have to make a decision about where is my faith and what is my dream going to be today. So maybe you need to get yourself some little reminders that push you to dream into the uncomfortable, maybe for the first time or again. And so there's another quote, it's by Henry V. And he talks about that if you hide a dream in your heart, even in the deepest corners and recesses of your heart, even there, God will rake for it. That you can't suppress a dream. Thanks. Don't worry. I cry freely. But that you can't bury it deep enough where God is not going to rake for that dream of yours. He's going to bring it right back up to the surface, no matter where you try to hide it in your heart. And so to try to run from God's calling like Jonah, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. He put that dream in you for a reason, and he's going to bring it right on back up to the surface. And so what's the point of living a life where you don't go after your dreams? A half life, you know, a substandard life. One where you tell yourself you're happy, but you can't stand to be around the people that have the dream you should have gone for. You start avoiding them, you know what I mean? They're like dating and happy, and you're like, oh, joy over there. Going over here, you know what I mean? Look at them all fired up, fundraising for special missions, out there singing and hoping people give them dollars. Look at that, it's just disgusting. Like, you know what I mean? Just ticked off that people are living their dream. And so suppressed dreams, they're going to lead to bitterness. And bitterness, it leads to a life without God. And on your deathbed, you're going to feel like, why didn't I do these things? You're not going to be worried about what you did do when you're laying there dying. You're going to think of all the things that you never went for. And so there's a quote that I love. It's called The Man in the Arena. Some of you guys might know it. It's by Teddy Roosevelt and all that stuff. But I love it because it helps me with my fear when it comes to dreaming. And it says that it's not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming. But who does actually strive to do the deeds? Who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. And I love that quote because it talks about how sometimes we let criticism, we let everybody's thoughts and all our fears keep us just in the nosebleed section, watching other people in the arena. And it says the only person who counts is other people who are going to step in there with you. And so don't let your fear keep you in the nosebleed section, watching other people actually be in the fight. Because vulnerability, that's the most accurate assessment of courage. It is the most accurate way to live a wholehearted life, is by being vulnerable. Now, the second point is, are you too lazy to dream? Let's go back over to 2 Kings chapter 4. In 2 Kings 4, starting in verse 18. It says, the child grew, and one day he went out to his father who was with the reapers. He said to his father, my head, my head. His father told the servant, carry him to his mother. After the servant had lifted him up and carried him to his mother, the boy sat on her lap until noon, and then he died. She went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God, then shut the door and went out. She called her husband and said, please send me one of the servants and a donkey so I can go to the man of God quickly and return. Why go to him today, he asked. It's not the new moon or the Sabbath. That's all right, she said. She saddled the donkey and said to her servant, lead on. Don't slow down for me unless I tell you. So she set out and came to the man of God at Mount Carmel. When he saw her in the distance, the man of God said to his servant Gehazi, look, There's the Shunammite. Run to meet her and ask her, are you all right? Is your husband all right? Is your child all right? Everything is all right, she said. When she reached the man of God at the mountain, she took hold of his feet. Gehazi came over to push her away. But the man of God said, leave her alone. She is in bitter distress, but the Lord has hidden it from me and has not told me why. Did I ask you for a son, my Lord? She said. Didn't I tell you, don't raise my hopes? Elisha said to Gehazi, tuck your cloak in your belt, take my staff in your hand, and run. Don't greet anyone you meet, and if anyone greets you, do not answer. Lay my staff on the boy's face. But the child's mother said, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave without you. So he got up and followed her. Gehazi went on ahead and laid the staff on the boy's face, but there was no sound or response. So Gehazi went back to meet Elisha and told him, the boy has not awakened. Other versions say that there is no sign of life. The child is still dead. And so this is where we dig into lazy Gehazi. Gehazi has to be told what to do constantly. Constantly, if you read through it. He's like, okay, tell her to do this. And it's not that he's physically lazy. He ran, you know, like he was supposed to. But he's emotionally lazy. You know, he puts in just enough effort. Elisha tells him, hey, like, what should we do? What should we do for her? She's such a great lady. And he has a great idea. He's right. A son was just the right thing. Was just the right dream that she never would have said out loud. And so he has tons of potential. That's why Elisha chose him to train him, is because he clearly has good ideas, but he always has to be told what to do. He doesn't take initiative. He has to be told to run. He has to be told, don't get distracted. Don't talk to other people. Don't do any of these things. And some of us, we just need to be told what to do all the time. I once heard someone share that if your house is on fire, I don't want you calling me for advice about what to do, you know? And so a lot of us have to grow past that place. Advice is great, we need it, but there are times when we need to be like, I should run. I need to run after this study. I need to run and go share my faith. I need to run and go get some discipling on this situation as opposed to just sitting in it, you know? Like, I need to run and get open. And so we need that initiative that Gehazi did not have. And we see that he pushes her away. Like, she's clearly upset, and he's like, you get off of him, stop. And so Gehazi is unfriendly. He is an unfriendly man. And Proverbs 18, verse 1, it says, an unfriendly person pursues selfish ends. And so when we're unfriendly, we're actually just selfish. And so in the fellowship, are you unfriendly? You know what I mean? Do you smile? Are you warm? Do people like talking to you? Do you go talk to them? Like, are you unfriendly? Because it says if you are, you're selfish, you know? And I remember I had a sister once in Boston. She was like, she was really upset with me. And she was like, I just feel like, what did she say? She was like, you hug everybody else. You hug everybody but me, right? And I was like, I do, right? And she was like, yeah, when you come to church, you hug all the people and you just skip me. Like, you'll hug both these people and not me. And I was like, I'm so sorry. You know, I didn't realize I was doing that. And what I realized was happening is that I was coming to church late, like kind of like just running in, trying to get to my seat. And so because of that, I'm not actually hugging anybody. You know what I mean? Like, I'm actually just trying to get to my seat, put my stuff down. So I'm kind of just receiving hugs. Like, people are coming and hugging me, and so I'm hugging them. And so if she doesn't hug me, I'm not hugging her because I'm not thinking about her. I'm not thinking about anybody. And so it made me realize, you know what? I'm just being selfish. And so I shared with her, like, hey, I'm not trying to single you out. I'm actually just undisciplined and disorganized, and people are hugging me, and I'm just kind of receiving and trying to sit down and, like, trying to, like, sing the song. Like, and it made me realize my selfishness is hurting her spiritually. Like, she's over here feeling like my women's ministry leader hates me because she doesn't hug me when I'm just scatterbrained. And I was like, I'm so sorry that I've just let Satan use my disorganization, my selfishness to really hurt you in that way because it was not on purpose, but I'm just being selfish, you know? And so selfishness, it makes us unfriendly. And this is the kind of stuff that Gehazi had to be, like, told not to be, not to do. And you notice he didn't help the boy. Like, he did what he was told. And you see, he goes back and tells him, hey, I was obedient. I did what you said, Elisha. I put the stick on the boy, and I don't know. It didn't work out. He's still dead. It's unfortunate. We should wrap it up. We should move on. And I mean, she got a chance. She had a dream. You gave it to her, and now he's gone. And it's sad. Like, you don't see, like, a brokenness about it from Gehazi. He's not sad. He's not hurt. He's kind of like, I did what I was told. of times I think that's why we want to be told what to do, so we can say, I did what you said. And it didn't work. I don't know. I mean, you said, tell her, not a Christian, not a disciple, not saved. And it didn't work. I don't know. She doesn't want to be saved. Like, we're like, you told me what to say. I did it. It didn't work. And it's all part of an emotional laziness. And so, you know, Gehazi realized what it takes to be successful in the kingdom of God, to do miracles, is it takes loving God with your whole heart, all your heart, soul, mind, strength. And that was not what Gehazi wanted. He's a half-hearted guy. Half his strength, half his mind, half his soul. And so it's important, like, what areas am I half-hearted in? Like, I'm upset that I'm not successful with God, but I'm half-hearted. You know, are you half-hearted in your righteousness? Where I'm righteous enough not to get discipled. That used to be, like, my standard. Like, I'm righteous enough to not get corrected, you know, but I'm not, like, hunger and thirst for righteousness, you know. Half-hearted in your purity, you know. Like, I'm not going to be immoral. I'm not going to sleep with them, but I'm going to get close to the line. I'm going to dress a certain type of way at school or at work because I want that attention, but I'm not going to, like, don't flirt with me. I'm a woman of God. Like, no. Are you half-hearted in your purity? Half-hearted in your righteousness? Half-hearted in your love? You know, I mean, I feel like I can always be like, oh, I'll do enough not to be a bad person. But it's like, you know, when God puts things on your heart to do for someone, and it's like, do I need to do that? And so we don't want to be half-hearted like lazy Gehazi. And, you know, the Shunammite woman, she knew. You got to know people. She knew he wasn't going to get the job done. He's going to do just enough. There's not going to be a miracle. That's why she's like, I'm not leaving. Like, that's great. You could send him on, but I'm going with you, Elisha. When you're ready, I'm ready. I'm not leaving. I'm not going back to my house without you. Because she understood who he was. Gehazi's going to do enough. He's going to be like, I know, he's still dead. It's really unfortunate. But she knew that wouldn't be Elisha's heart. And so people know us, you know. They know if we're half-hearted. Sometimes we think that kind of thing's a secret. It's not so much, you know. And it shows. It shows if we're willing to go the extra mile to rescue people. Yeah. You know, how do we work with the weak? I know for me, I used to feel so indignant when I was a campus student, and I became a disciple at 19, and I had to repent of a lot of, like, partying and, you know, sleeping around and drugs and all this stuff. And so when I became a disciple, I would get so frustrated when other people in the campus ministry would do those things. Now, if you're in the campus ministry, this is a very righteous group, so yay. Most are a little rough, and so that's kind of a common thing. You know what I mean? You're young, and you just do, like, foolish things all the time. And I would get ticked. I would be like, why does she just get to sleep with people, right? And my disciple would be like, she doesn't get to just sleep with people. I was like, yes, she does. She's not even trying. She had a bad day and got high, and that's not fair. I had a bad day. I wish to get high. Why do I have to keep it together and she doesn't? This isn't fair. If I was in sin, you guys would be all over me, but her, oh, yeah, hope you're okay. Like, I would just feel, I was so upset. And I would, like, quote scriptures because I was like, you know, brainy scripture, bad-hearted person. And I would be like, well, Paul says, don't I inwardly burn. I'm burning over here, trying to keep it together, and it's not fair that she just gets to be in sin and nobody cares. And what it took for my heart to change is God had to humble me. I had to become weak. I didn't know how to work with the weak because I didn't think I was. And then once God smashed me to where I had all these same sins in my life all of a sudden, oh, now I get it. Now I get what probably pushed homegirl over the edge. Now I get why she feels that way. Now people confess the sin, I'm not like, move on. I'm like crying. I'm like, I understand the self-harm that's happening here. You are hurting yourself, sister, as opposed to before where it's like, you're kind of slowing us down. And so a lot of times it takes being weak to understand the weak. And so that was not Gehazi. He was lazy Gehazi, and this wasn't his heart. And he was actually just selfish, is kind of what it was. And this gets exposed later. The next chapter over with Naaman, you know, he comes to be cleansed, and Naaman wants to pay Elisha, and Elisha's like, no, I don't need any payment. Gehazi runs after him, his big runner, runs after him, and is like, I'll take it. I'll take the clothes and the gold, and I'll take all that stuff. A couple chapters later, we don't even see him with the man of God anymore. Gehazi's now beside the king. And so what he wanted was always going to come to the surface. Selfishness always comes to the surface. And for many years, I thought I was such a lazy person. And it was a real revelation when I decided to really think about it. And I was like, are you lazy? Or are you just selfish? Like, do I just not have motivation to do that? Or am I just enjoying what I'm doing more than doing that? I just don't want to do that. I'd rather sit here and do nothing. So I'm going to drag my feet because I want to do that. Like, am I unfriendly? Am I not sharing my faith because I'm scared? Or am I just lazy? I just don't wish to be inconvenienced, you know? And so it's important to comb through the emotional laziness that we can have when it comes to dealing with things. So we don't want to be too scared to dream. We don't want to be like lazy gehazy. Let's go to our third point and our last point, where we're going to wrap it up. Our last point is God will resurrect your dream. So I don't want to give away the ending, but it ends well. In 2 Kings chapter 4, in verse 32, it says, when Elisha reached the house, there was the boy lying dead on his couch. Like, she put him in his bed. She was like, he's in your bed waiting for you, Elisha. So there he is on his couch. He went in, shut the door on the two of them, and prayed to the Lord. Then he got on the bed and lay on the boy, mouth to mouth, eyes to eyes, hands to hands. And he stretched himself out on him. The boy's body grew warm. Elisha turned away and walked back and forth in the room. Then he got on the bed and stretched out on him once more. The boy sneezed 7 times and opened his eyes. Elisha summoned Gehazi and said, call the Shunammite. And he did. When she came, he said, take your son. She came in, fell at his feet, and bowed to the ground. Then she took her son and went out. And so God can resurrect your dream. A couple of things we see here just to close out, and how does God resurrect our dreams? First thing is, you see, Elisha doesn't settle for good enough. Warm was not good enough. Warm was not going to do it. He's like, no, no, no. I'm going to need you to get up. I need you to get up. And so with our dreams, we can't settle for, you know, maybe this is just as far as God wants to take me. This is it. Okay, I'll just be surrendered. Sitting there in sadness is not surrender. That's not what surrender looks like. And so he was like, no, no, you're going to need to be more than warm. I'm going to need you to get up. Second thing is, you notice he closed the door and he prayed. At no point did Gehazi pray, ever. He just ran in, put a stick on him, and was like, it didn't work. It was very sad. You know, but he went and he prayed to the Lord. You have to cover your dreams in prayer. I can't say, oh, God, why haven't you done this or that for me? And then someone asked me, how often do you pray about it? And I'm like, every so often. You know, there are people who get baptized and they'll be like, I prayed for my dad every day to become a disciple. I'll be like, wow, I don't think I pray for anybody every day to become a disciple. Like, it's an emotional laziness where the dream's not covered in prayer, and then we're mad that God didn't do it, and we don't even like to ask him about it, you know? And so you have to cover it in prayer the way Elisha did. Number three is, people are going to be a part of the healing. He wasn't like, don't worry, God's just going to make him poof, he's just going to presto on up. No, he was like, I need to close the door. This is me and him, face to face, hands to hands, eyes to eyes, mouth to mouth. Like, people have to be involved in your healing. And some of us don't like that. We're like, I think I'm just going to heal on my own. I got it. I don't need you. All my business. He is all in his business. He is way up in the boy's business right now. And that's what it takes sometimes to heal. And for me, I do feel like the women that God has given me during this time have just done miracles in my heart. And now I'm emotional again. But they have just healed my heart so much. I mean, I don't know what I would do without Anna. Anna's like my baby, guys. Like, she's like, she is my little European baby. And I love her very much. But she's like a wildflower. Like, I don't know how to explain it, because I don't know what kind of flower she's going to be. You know what I mean? Like, she does not conform to the box. And I love it. Anna is not motivated by people. She's not, like, righteous for, like, the rest of you guys. Like, she genuinely reads the Bible and is like, I think God wants me to do this. And I'm like, wow, that's intense. That's what he wants. Like, I love it. I love that she's not motivated by people. And it's helped my heart so much. I love Lizzie. Lizzie's my little warrior, man. I cry in deep times with Lizzie. Like, she'll just be talking about her life, like, regularly, and I'm, like, crying, and she's, like, concerned. Like, but it's because I watch her fight, and I'm like, man, I do not like fighting. I don't, in the tug of war of life, I'm just a big kind of, like, oh, just take it. Oh, forget it. I was talking to somebody, I think it was Anna's brother, And I was like, yeah, I don't like zombies. Oh, we're talking about zombies, but we're talking about zombies. And I was like, I just feel like I would just give up and just be like, oh, okay, just eat me and I'll just be a zombie too. This is just really stressful, like all this running and evading. And I think just take me, I'll just be a zombie too. Because fight is hard for me. But Lizzie fights. She fights to be right with God and right with people. And I love it, you know. She's my little itty bitty warrior, and it's wonderful. I think of Regina. Regina's my little rock, man. I don't know where Regina's at, but Regina will have storms in her life, and you would never know. Because she's about to be at that front door right there with your communion and your envelope, ready to take your money. Like she's just immovable. You know, Mike and I used to try to hide from Regina when we'd come late to church because we'd be like, Regina's going to see us. Like, I mean, that's my rock. She is going to be there. She's going to be at her class. She's going to be at Bible talk. She's going to be at midweek. Like, she's just immovable. And I just appreciate that so much. And Amanda. Amanda's like my little bear. Because she's so cuddly and warm and sweet. But sometimes she gets all grizzly, like, and I love it. I love a fierce girl, you know. I like it when people have that fire. But she teaches me so much about forgiveness. She'll share, like, horrible things that have happened to her. And she'll be like, can I just forgive people? Because people are human. And me, I'm like, you forgave them. Like, I'm over here struggling. Like, I get real, like, defensive for people. I'm always like, do you want me to fight them? Which is, like, terrible because, yeah. But she shows me all the time, like, no, we can do this and we can overcome. And she's just, I just feel like she just cuddles me like a bear. And then she gets all like, I have a lot of emotions. And I'm like, yeah, me too. And I don't know what I would do without you. I think watching you fight to always get up and give, it gives me so much courage, you know. There's other people, but I should probably wrap this up soon. But I love being here with Salma. I don't know where she's at. She's getting ready to baptize somebody. But, I mean, I love beautiful Salma. She's so humble. Like, when you talk to Salma, she, like, leans. Like, oh, like. And I love it because it's so humble. She's like, I want to hear what you're saying, all of it. And I'm like, all of it is not worthy of this attention right now. But she's like, I don't want to miss a word, you know. And I love that kind of humility. I think Regine is like what it's like to see visions fulfilled. You know, I mean, in my mind, I want to be like, oh, this is amazing how she's transformed so much and is living her dream. She was always kind of like this, though. You know what I mean? Like, she was always kind of the put-together, driven deal. And so it's just so cool to see God's answered promises in her life and her husband and leading powerfully. And it's like, why would I not dream for people? It clearly happens. It clearly comes to fruition if you just give it a little bit of time, you know? I'm so grateful for Sarah, just her tenderness. I was telling a sister over here how I cry in every D time, and they're just like, they're not even like correcting me and like chopping me up like that, but I'm just like, I have feelings, and they're just so tender, and I'm so grateful for just the soft hands that they kind of, right now, are like, okay, Chanel's all fragile, so I just appreciate it, and I see it, and Sharon gives me little kisses all the time. She always gives me little kisses. Sharon has been a wonderful support through all of this, just being a mom, you know, just helping carry me from coast to coast. And so I'm just so grateful, sis. But that's part of how healing works. Healing works through people all up in your business is how it comes together. To kind of close out, for me, I have had dreams totally come back. Life is like actually like happy and shiny again. I know I cry a lot, so it seems like it's not, but it is actually really wonderful. And soon we're getting ready to move. We're getting ready to move to Riverside. And I am so excited and I'm so happy. But I think part of the things that excite me is, it's funny, is it's actually a lot of you guys. Like, when I, like Matt was telling me, Rodriguez, that he's like, you know, I'm from Riverside, like Moreno Valley kind of area, me and my mom. And I was like, oh, really? Because what I took from that is I could meet a Matt Rodriguez? We could baptize a Matt? Oh my goodness. Then Erica Parada, her parents came, and her dad was like, I work in Riverside, and we don't live too far from there. And I'm like, we could meet an Erica? Like, Haley was like, I live kind of by Rialto. It's really not that far. That's where I'm from. And I'm like, I could have a Haley? I could baptize a Haley? Like, the idea that people like you are out there waiting is everything. It resurrects the dream. To think that you guys are out there in your little unsaved forms, but you will be saved. And that is a very exciting thought. And so to close, the way to resurrect a dream is to make sure that it was God's dream in the first place. A lot of times, lessons like this, we're like, I'm going to write a list of my dreams. Okay, well, all of those start with I. You know what I mean? I am going to do this, and I'm going to do that. What we have to do is we have to sit down, put a chair across from you, and be like, God, what's your dream for me? What's my purpose? Why am I here? Why was I born this way? Why do I live here? Why do my parents live here or live there? What's your dream for me? And then, you know, brace yourself for what he might say. He might tell you some different things about yourself. And you want to remember that dreams have a cost. You know, God had a dream and it cost him his son. And so for us, our dreams, living out God's dream, all of it, it's going to cost us. And so I want to close with one scripture here in Romans 8. In Romans chapter 8. And I love this scripture. I love it because I believe God is good. And so sometimes I read things and I'm like, doesn't that just scream the goodness of God? And other people are like, what? But this one to me, I'm like, wow. And so in Romans chapter 8, in verse 31, it says, what then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? And if there's anything you leave convinced of tonight, I hope it's that God would graciously give you everything that you dream of. I mean, if he wouldn't withhold giving his son for you, what makes you think your little dream is something he would withhold for you? He wouldn't even withhold his own son. Like, he's already given you the most that he could ever give. If I was like, I would give up Bellamy for you, what makes you think I wouldn't give you, like, my phone or something? Like, you know what I mean? Like, these lesser things are nothing compared to what God's already given. And so I just hope that tonight can change your mind to be willing to dream for God, because there is nothing he wouldn't want to give to you. Thank you.